Hello, I'm Ione Butler, and today let's talk about unity with none other than Shaun Monson. Did I say that right, Shaun Monson? Just checking. Shaun wrote, produced, and directed an incredible movie called Unity that I was lucky enough to see an advanced screening of. It was nearly 2 years ago now, and it had such a huge impact on me that I have not eaten meat since. And I talk about it constantly. And it was really recently released.
On demand.
Yeah.
Worldwide on demand now. So it's in over 100 countries and a dozen languages, and that seems to be the easiest way for people to have access to it. They don't have to go to a theater. They don't have to go to a particular network. They can just look it up on whatever platform they prefer.
Perfect. Do you mind if I show a quick clip of it?
No, go right ahead.
Perfect.
Think of now what the universe is. Millions of galaxies. And among those galaxies is our little planet.
For it is here, and only here, that we are working out our destiny.
We all exist in the same atmosphere.
Why then do we separate and distinguish?
Always striving against each other for power and supremacy.
So what was the inspiration for this film?
Well, I'd done a film before called Earthlings that was particularly about how we treat animals, only about how we treat animals. And then Unity, sort of the inspiration for that came, it was an extension of that, really, because it wasn't really just how we treat animals or people. It was why we cultivate love and empathy for some.
Mm-hmm.
And we even teach it to our children. And then in the same breath have this attitude of total aggression toward others. And so that began to nag at me. And that was the spark.
I think that was the catalyst for me into vegetarianism. I'm trying to be a vegan. I haven't quite got there yet.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the first time that I actually looked at animals that we eat as living things that should have compassion, just like cats and dogs do. And I think the film really shows that in a way that's not what I love in the way that you did it. It wasn't obnoxious. It wasn't, you should be this and you should be that. It was just a very honest, open way of sort of just showing this is what we're doing.
Well, the funny thing about what you said about you hadn't thought of it before is that that's the, I don't mean to say brilliance, but that's the sort of deviant brilliance of removing it totally from the public so that they don't see mm-hmm. how this stuff is produced. And that's why your labels on all the food, they're usually cartoons mm-hmm. and they're usually bright as a red barn. There's sort of rolling green hills, and there are
happy animals.
Two cows, maybe, with all this space. And that's by design. And then if you see what really happens, it's, of course, nothing like that at all. It's quite horrific. But even showing that is they've had laws in place to forbid people from mm-hmm. seeing, because they know that it affects the enterprise, the animal enterprise. So then all the people who finally see this stuff go, we're sort of stunned mm-hmm. because we had no idea that was the process.
I recently watched Cowspiracy and learned about that and mm-hmm. how there's legislation now in place where if you try and right. stop these, I don't know what you call them,
gag. Well, you go to jail.
Yeah, you can go to jail. So are you at risk of going to jail for any of your...
Well, no, I mean, I don't think so. I mean, even with Earthlings, there was... And there's been, before the... before the ag gag laws, which are recent, go back to 2005, and you have the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act, which was passed in 2005. They used the word terrorism in there, which was kind of alarming because the animal activists hadn't killed any people. So it seems like if you use the word terrorism, it usually, it's violent.
Mm-hmm.
So when something's non-violent, why are you using the word post 9/11? Why are you using the word terrorism? That was in 2005. And if you go back to the late 80s, there was another one, I forget the name of it, but it was done by the biomedical research community because mm-hmm. they didn't want people showing what's happening in the lab. So they made that a crime. Basically, it's a crime. I know this sounds conspiratory, which really isn't my thing, but it's essentially a crime to tell the truth.
Yeah. Yeah.
And now you're dealing with a documentary film, which is the nonfiction film.
Mm-hmm.
And you have two problems. One, how much truth can you tell before mm-hmm. you get yourself in trouble? Number two, how much truth does the viewer want to see? Because they don't want too much truth, because mm-hmm. you're kind of spoiling the fun. You're kind of spoiling everything. You're spoiling Thanksgiving. You're spoiling Christmas dinner. You're spoiling my shoes that I want to buy. You're spoiling the milk in my coffee. You're spoiling everything. So yeah. Now you're like, well, okay, this is the nonfiction film. Yeah, so you find yourself taking truth out of it. Or just enough to maybe take it one step further.
The whole purpose of these podcasts and doing this was because I feel like when it comes down to it, people are good. And if we did know the truth about so many things, the world would be in a much better place with not poisoning ourselves on a daily basis with the things we eat, the products we consume, like just what we're doing to the planet and what's happening, if people know that. And you're doing that. Like, is it? I kind of lost my train of thought with that.
You mean in terms of people that are inherently good, but
yeah, and that's the point. And so, but when you show people the truth, I think a lot of them will, and you know, will change, will look at things differently, and will start doing something. How have you found the impact of the film?
Yeah, I can tell you. Like two things. Well, one thing that definitely happens is that you have your own preconceived understanding, which you probably come by honestly because you were raised with it. Mm-hmm. You were taught to do it by either society, your family, school, the culture you're in. Okay, so who can blame people for that? You know, you grow up in whatever you grow up in. So then you hear something new like this. And so the new thought or truth begins to come into collision and it begins to bump up against these taboos, if you will, that you had in your head. And there's an identity thing for a minute, which is why you sometimes hear people they're critical.
Resentful, hesitant about it.
Because it's
defensive.
It's an identity that's being sort of threatened, which they've cultured and nurtured for X number of years.
Mm-hmm.
So I always have compassion. As impatient as I can get to with sometimes with the willful idiocy that people have, or their just willingness to just drink whatever comes out of the tap as truth, and you say, well, okay, just hold on a second. I'm not going all the way over here to some conspiracy thing, but just for a second, just consider, you know, what you think you are and what you think you know, because it was all taught to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a great question to ask someone is to tell me a truth about you that comes from direct experience and nothing else based on something you were taught or imprinted upon that you know to be absolutely 100% true, and then if I talk to you 50 years from now, it won't have changed.
That's awesome. Do people come up with anything? Do they have any answers?
Yeah, they usually say that they love their family.
Okay.
One thing they know absolutely to be true. Now you see if you can name a second thing to be true. Like, in terms of, let's say, being vegan. I believe, more than something I was taught or inherited, that being kind to animals is an absolute truth. Just like I'd be kind to humans, there's not a separation. I'm not trying to separate stuff. So I think if you interviewed me 50 years from now, I'd still be vegan, because mm-hmm. that would be as true to my essence as loving, let's say, my family would mm-hmm. be. So you begin, this is sort of now into consciousness now we're talking about here, but you begin to look for those parts of yourself that are unchangeable and mm-hmm. abide there a little bit more than in all this transitory passing stuff that keeps happening that you're reacting to all the time.
How did you come to this place of being? What was it? Were you born this way? Or like, was there a change? Was there a shift? For me, I think I was depressed a lot when I was young. And then it just came from a lot of reading books that kind of made me start to look at my mind and how I was, and just, mm-hmm. I just started to completely see things in a different way.
Right.
How did you?
Same thing. I mean, I wasn't born, I'm probably born the way most, let's say, Westerners are. In this case, I was born and raised in America, typical American diet. Fundamentally normal American upbringing. Some trauma, you know, divorced parents type thing, but I really can't say I've had a negative or a hard life. But you still at some point might begin to question something for whatever reason. Like I said, it might be some built-in thing you've had, and then something new begins to sort of butt up against it, and you begin to just kind of question it. And you look into that, and you want to sort of understand it a little better. And that can either grow and expand, or you might turn from it because it might be too much work. It might be, you know, sometimes looking in the mirror can be illuminating, or it can be discouraging. mm-hmm. you know, or both, which is okay too. So I was just, I couldn't sort of, after I saw the first, in this case, animal footage, first time I saw animal footage, which was pigs being slaughtered, and I had been raised eating bacon, you know, which was a staple breakfast food type thing. Didn't matter how much I had liked that before, I didn't want any part of it mm-hmm. anymore. And then it began to just sort of nag at me at night, like, that's one animal, you know, mm-hmm. what else, what's chicken, what's happening with, you know, cows, and it just began to go from there. And it nagged at me more than any desire to just live the normal life that I wanted to have. That was frankly more interesting, mm-hmm. more truthful, more real, more mysterious. So I just pursued that. And that was what led to Earthlings. And then in the years to come with Unity, just take it further. You know, like, why are we constantly at each other's throats? Mm. You know, what, let's say, what's 2015 at the time of this recording. We're about to go into 2016. We know that we are black, white, gay, straight, young, old, fat, skinny, you know, Jew, Gentile, whatever. We like, all this stuff is known. Mm. And it's not a revelation. It's not like it just happened this year and we're kind of reacting to all this variety. You know, it's like, it's always been here. So, mm-hmm. like, what? Why can't we get along? Like, what? Knowing that that's been here, like, why can't we get along? And I realized that it would be peace on Earth, which everybody says they want, would not come from anything we invent. There's no way. Because we invented the wheel, and that was probably a pretty big deal when mm-hmm. that happened. You got a lot of broken backs there for a long time, carrying the world literally on your shoulders, and you like push stuff and it rolled. And then we began to write and paint on cave walls, and we began to build, you know, steeples that point to the sky, and we began to write poetry and symphonies, and there were mathematics and technology, and we went into space, and we've done all this incredible stuff. Even this thing you have right here where we can talk to the world like that, but we're still savages with each other. None of it has stopped us from this duality, like seeing opposites in one another. And that opposites really stuck with me too on Unity, because it's what we're also being fed by. So every movie, every TV show you watch, it's
conflict.
Is conflict.
I every just talked one. About that in, yeah, that's why I'm tired of seeing.
I'm weary of it too. It's like, I'm waiting for the great filmmakers and artists to write a different storyline, because, you know, Joseph Campbell wrote the book, Hero with a Thousand Faces. He's like, this, you're telling the same story, and the Disney films do it, and the little kids films do it, and it's in our music, it's certainly in our sports, it's in our politics. Like, everywhere you turn, there's this, what side are you on? Mm-hmm. And I just find it so tiresome now. I just find it such an old, weary, like, thousands and thousands of years we've been telling that story. Like, we got nothing else. Is this realm that we're in, and we're only here for a few decades, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. you know, we're here for a life measured in decades. Like, we got nothing else
to figure out. I think the core of human beings is to connect. Mm-hmm. Like, that's when we're happy, when we're together, like, when you do things for each other, you feel alive when you mm-hmm. give. And I think most people in the day-to-day want to connect, and yet when you put it together as a planet, it just, it doesn't work like that. And so there seems like there's these internal forces. I think it does, the change totally comes from within us. It does. There is that goodness, that love, that connection, the compassion, it's there within us, and yet it's not really working in the world. Why?
Well, it could be. It could be. I don't pretend to have the answers. That's a great question.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Got out. Got the whole planet going. Probably, again, identities with, okay, no two minds think alike. So that's okay.
Yeah.
You could not think alike. And I always think one day, maybe centuries from now, when we stopped having wars, let's just assume, like, abolition, like the suffragettes, like any number of issues we actually got beyond war. And you might have people at the UN or whatever saying, well, we don't agree with each other, but we don't kill each other anymore.
We don't
agree. We don't agree all the time, but we don't, like, bomb stuff. We stopped doing that. Like, that's like those Neanderthals who still, like, just bomb everybody and just shoot everything. But we don't do that. We just disagree. So that capacity is there, like you say, the goodness is there, but we get so identified with this stuff we were taught, whether it was, your nationality or your religious belief or your intellectual status or whatever it is. This is this, you get into this ego thing. Mm-hmm. So now you bring up ego, which we touch on in the film. And what is this ego thing? This identity with some other supposed part of ourselves that likes to separate or distinguish itself from another. There's an interesting book. It's a religious book. It's called A Course in Miracles. And and the book talks about, tells a sort of metaphor or parable about how it all began, which is sort of like a religious story about why we separated. And it essentially said that in the book, to paraphrase it, there was all of, everybody was living in a peaceful realm at one point, and for some reason, a certain number of people began to perceive themselves as different from others. Mm-hmm. And they called themselves, they were referred as the separated ones. And this became quite alarming to the others who were not seeing anybody as separate. And so the book goes quite far with this notion, but it basically says that a realm was devised where you could go down and essentially in time and space work out why you perceive all these opposites in one another and find that oneness once again. And that's according to one text. Now, if you look at some other texts, such as the Hindu myths, they have a fantastic one. If I can just press the point just a moment.
Of course
further,
you can. No, yeah, you keep going.
Where there's a great Hindu metaphor, I think, or Indian metaphor that I heard when I was traveling and shooting Unity. I went to India, and it talked about four different ages of man, if you will. And each age was represented symbolically by a sacred cow, because the cow's a sacred animal in India. So in the first age, you had this beautiful, majestic cow on all four legs, and she represented the ushering in of a new era. And mankind was so kind with one another and so loving. They never had a thought of separation toward each other. There were no doors on any of the homes because there would be no need to ever keep anything out. Mm-hmm. I mean, we almost can't get our heads around that today. And they acted toward each other with kindness, compassion, love, sympathy at all times. And that was this first age. The second age in the myth, the way it's told, the cow appears on three legs instead of four. One leg is missing symbolically. And so you have a golden age, you have now, let's say, a silver age, and the people are still beautiful and kind, but before they interact with each other, they have to pause for a minute. They have to just think for a second before they act. So you can see just a little bit of a slipping has begun. And then the third age, which is probably a bronze age, the cow appears on only two legs. And when I read this myth, I was just fascinated by the lesson it was teaching. Of course, no cow can stand on two legs, so it had to be propped up. And the prop was scripture, holy writings, teachings, whatever. In other words, the people had forgotten how to conduct themselves with one another, and they have to actually read in books to be reminded how they're supposed to treat. Mm-hmm. So that's how far they've slipped away, which I thought when I heard it, that's where we are today. Mm-hmm. That's where we were. And that isn't it, because the myth goes one step further. It says, no, there's a fourth age, which is perhaps, let's say, the steel, age of steel or something. The cow has one leg left. And there are books and holy writings and things for people to read, but they don't read them anymore. And if they did read them, they don't understand them. That's where we're at right now.
Okay. Yeah.
Apparently, if the myth is to be used as any sort of parallel for where we are. So how do you get back out of this? How do you get back? How do you let go of all this attachment to all our separations? Unity, you know. You recognize that life is, as we say in the film, multitudinous in how it's expressed. It's expressed in all these different ways. No big deal. Mm-hmm. No big deal. It's expressed as a flower. It's expressed as a spider. It's expressed as mold. It's expressed as a cow. It's expressed in all these ways. And all these beings come into existence and go out of existence, usually in a period of years or decades, all of them, us included. And if the scientists are right, so does the planet, so does the universe. Mm-hmm. It's a transitional thing. So you begin to say, well, what am I before? I was told my name is Shaun, that I was American, that I was white or Swedish or whatever these things, or vegan, or a college graduate, or a homeowner, or any of these things.
An actor.
Whatever, a documentarian. Like, before all those things, who am I? What was I? Who was I 8 days before my conception? You know, and you begin to think about these things. Because that's the only capital you can take with you in the years to come, because everything else is just experiential and transitory. So
it's so funny you say that, because the two podcasts I did before was with Prince E. And he keeps asking me, who are you? And like, through talking to him, just getting on that level of, we identify with, I'm this, I'm that, I'm that. And none of that is.
Right.
None of that is. And so you were saying it's the realizing unity and everything. For people that, just for people that kind of aren't there yet, like how do you, like something like, I feel like your film should be seen by the world. Like I think it would make such a difference if just the whole, I mean, it does, it has a huge impact to whoever watches it, but that would be great if we could make the whole world see it. But other than that, what do you think is going to be that shift? What can people do? That's what I always kind of like to like have it be actionable. What can people do, do you think?
Yeah. Well, it's tough to tell people what to do. Sometimes, like when I finished Earthlings, which was 10 years ago now, I screened it a couple of times. People said, oh, you should have a call to action at the end. You should say, do. And
yeah.
I thought, okay, I get that. And I thought, well, we just showed 95 minutes of some pretty heavy stuff. I don't know now if I have to say, okay.
Which we just leave them alone for a second.
Just let them, they've seen it, they went in. If they watched it, let them go out and make their own choices. Mm-hmm. Same with Unity. You know, it's hard to sort of, we like to put leashes on our animals, and a lot of people like to put leashes on one another and kind of lead each other around. But you can only plant the seed, and then that's it.
You see, it's fascinating you say that, because I watch, and this was something else I was speaking with Princey about recently. I watch stuff, and I am if I'm moved by it, I want to do it. Makes me want to do, and then a lot of the times I don't know where to start with what to do. So I saw Virunga like a little while back, and it just broke my heart, and I donated, and then I was like, well, what else can I do? And then I keep hearing about the water crisis, there's a massive drought in California, and then learning that was 80% of it is animal agriculture. And, everybody's being told to turn their taps off and take short showers and stuff when we're 3% of the problem and 80% of the problem is agriculture.
Right.
And then I'm like, what do I do? So I feel like there's an element of planting the seed. And then for those who want to do, get making it actionable, because otherwise it's just so overwhelming. I just don't know where to start.
Well, okay. Understood. But you are doing it. You are your own internal universe. So by doing it, and the people you're interacting with, you're radiating it.
Yeah.
You're radiating it more than what you say, more than what you might type up, in a way, more than what you do.
Yeah.
Being it and feeling that you're being it is probably the best guru you can give to anyone in terms of a teacher or a guru. Just by, you can go ahead and watch the Olympics, and you'll see these Olympians and they're just like incredible. The interviews are interesting, but just what they are, and you're inspired and you want to have to go to the gym and work out harder or do something. I mean, that's how inspiration is.
It's so funny to say that, because I was like really emotional after watching Virunga, and called a friend of mine who recommended it, and I was like, I just don't know what to do, the world is so bad, and I don't know what to do. And he said, be the change you want to see in the world.
Which is exactly what
you're saying.
So just be it, because otherwise you will get discouraged. And isn't it funny, one last thought about that, we're born into this world and there's all these problems, and I'm not saying we're supposed to fix it or we're not supposed to fix it, but somehow this mantle comes upon us like we're born into this, and we need to fix it.
Mm.
Like, we didn't make the mess, but we have to clean it up. I would love to think about that more and analyze that a little bit more. And it goes back to our religions as well, even if you go to the Old Testament, the Garden of Eden story, which is believed by three major religions, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. So three major religions who are in collision with each other have the same biblical base, but they have three different names for the same biblical gods. They don't get along with each other. And they have that same story at the beginning, whether they believe it to be a myth or a fact, where you have two beings born into a perfect realm, and they're not supposed to do this, but they're supposed to do that, and they decide to try this, and suddenly they have to fix everything. But they just were just born into this place. They were just born. And somehow we've been taught that we're responsible for all this stuff, even though we're sort of coming at it innocently. Now, if we're not innocent, if we are contributing to it, then that's a different lesson that we're going to go through. But when you see a film like Virunga or Cowspiracy or any number of those wonderful, worthy documentaries that are, you know, just tremendous, and you feel this call to action, just the fact that you watched it and you received it and you're not contributing to it anymore, I mean, that's there. You can look at a city of lights at night and that is a shining light, you know, in that city. There are dim lights and there are bright lights, and that is a bright light shining. And then maybe other lights will brighten up too, or someone else will watch the film. I don't know.
No, thanks.
I wish I had the answers to that.
I like that.
I think about it too.
Just quickly back to the film. You had over like 100 A-list celebrities narrating this thing, which is just incredible.
Yeah.
Was it difficult getting them on board?
Yeah.
How did you?
It took four and a half years. Well, wow. you go to 100 people's houses, and we're at one house right now. Okay, 99 more to go. Well, the idea was to have multiple narrators, of course. It was called Unity, and there were 5 chapters. There were going to be 6, and I thought, let's do, 4 or 5 narrators a chapter. It was an arbitrary number, but I thought no one's ever had, let's say, 25 narrators before. I thought that would be different. And we'd have different voices.
Yeah.
We'd have different ages, and they'd all bring their own whateverness to it. By whatever life they've lived, if they agreed to say yes to be in this film and to read these words, then I wanted to hear how they would learn, what their inflections would be, what their breath would be. I just wanted it. That's the unity of it. Let it be. And then so that's what we embarked on, and then we actually recorded 35. We sort of overshot it, our goal, and the strangest thing happened. I watched it and I just thought, I can't believe I'm saying this, but it's not enough. It's like, it's really not enough. Like, it should be a tapestry of voices, a chorus of voices. So we more than doubled it. We just kept going. And 100 was never really the initial goal, but it got up to 75 and 85. And I was pretty locked on the picture at 85. I had re-edited 100 times. Well, not really, but a lot of times. I'd written the script, 42 drafts of the script. So I'd gone through it and gone through it. And I felt, this is the text. This is the picture. This is the voice. And I think by the time I got somewhere over 90, I thought, well, now it's just a round number. And you could always add one more voice. And each new final person would bring something to it. You know, the first narrator who agreed to do it was a musician. It was Dr. Dre, as it turned out. He was the first one to say yes. And in the end, the last one was a musician. It was Selena Gomez, who was one of the youngest ones. And when I recorded her, she was the last one. It was last summer, a year ago last summer. And she knew who Joseph Campbell was, who we quote, and I was impressed because she admitted, she was like, I'm a singer, I'm a musician, but I know who this guy is, and I think this stuff's interesting.
Yes.
And I was like, wow, just be yourself and read this text. And then editing all those voices together was a bit of a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
What was the pitch to get them?
The initial pitch was, it's a film about why we can't get along. After thousands and thousands of years, and not since that song in the 80s, We Are the World, has a bunch of artists come together and read a page of dialogue or one or two lines of a lyric. And so I said, that's our sort of example. We're going to do a We Are the World, like, in a documentary. And so I had everybody would read 2 pages. And so right away we got like 15 people off top to say, oh, that sounds different. I'll do it. And we recorded them in a half an hour, you know, they would sit down. Unless they wanted to talk about things more.
Yeah.
But sometimes they'd come in and it'd be done. And sometimes they'd want to sit and say, well, what does this mean? And they had no monitors. They didn't have anything to look at. Mm-hmm. They're just reading cold.
And did you direct them pieces. Much?
Yeah. Well, only if, like I said, I didn't want to tell them. You know, I would sometimes ask him for a breath or a beat because I knew I'm going to show something and I might need a second for this to unfold. So can you give me just a breath here for a minute? And then as I was editing them, as I got later into it, after I recorded the first third of them, and I knew where I was headed, I laid my voice down first. So I had a bit of a pacing for it. And then I would step on my voice with each of theirs gradually. And then I knew who... You know, I knew exactly what was happening. I could tell them. However, what I didn't know until I recorded them each individually was how they would sound next to the people that bookmarked them or bookended them. So I'd always have them record a little extra at the head and the tail because I might put it in there and go, you know, she's actually better if she goes first and he goes second instead of the other way. So sometimes it would dictate itself in the editing. So that was an experience.
Have you had feedback from any of the people now they've seen it?
Yeah, the ones who did. I mean, I've got, you know, one is, of course, Joaquin, who I've worked with previously Joaquin Phoenix, and he saw it, and you know, he just called me, and this was a while ago now, but he called and just said, "Oh, you know, man, now this makes you really think." And Pamela Anderson was another one, and she just, if you just sit and take the whole thing in, mm-hmm. as you've done, because if you watch only the first half of it or the first third of it and you shut it off, you'll miss something, mm-hmm. because it's hard in the beginning. I always describe it a bit like Dante's Inferno. You have to kind of descend before you ascend. So when we're descending, you're looking at a lot of conflict and suffering, and you might want to turn from it. But in the end, if you wait and go all the way through, you're sort of, you see this thing. And I saved this fish scene for the end. As you probably remember, there's a scene with a fish at the end, which there's an animal chunk more toward the beginning, but I saved this one animal shot for the end because...
In the competition where they have to...
Yeah. And I just saved it because I thought, you know, this is an animal issue. I could probably include it with the other animal issues, but I thought I'd save it because after you've heard the whole film, if we've done our job right, which I think we have, you are now seeing every life form a little differently.
Yeah.
Whether it's a snail in the rain, whether it's a bird, I mean, anything you're seeing differently. So now that I show a fish, which is not always easy for people to have compassion for a fish, you can mm-hmm. really cuddle it and pet it. And you see that and you go, you see this scene with this fish and you identify.
Well, that's funny you say that because I was like, all right, I'm a vegetarian. And then people would say, oh, but you're going to be a pescatarian. I was mm-hmm. like, no. Mm-hmm. No, and it was that scene. Mm-hmm. It was that very scene. I was like, no, I can't eat fish again, though.
So you begin to identify with this, you know, the suffering of another. And that's a quote we have, I think, from Joseph Campbell or the Bhagavad Gita somewhere. It says that consciousness is when we feel the suffering of every creature in our own hearts.
Yeah.
That is awakening. That is the harmony of being. You begin to realize that you and I share the same space, that we breathe, that we feel, that if it pinches you, it hurts you just like it would me. And you begin to remove yourself from what we call in the film this primal view of life, which is more of a sort of a Neanderthal grunting, living by killing, which is what we're still doing.
Mm-hmm.
And you sort of evolve into this living by loving, which is the big step that we ask the viewer to take. You take this big leap. And you know, I don't really correlate it in the film, but if you look at the 20th century, the early 20th century, and look at Gandhi and you look at Hitler, who were contemporaries, and Gandhi wrote letters to Hitler, you know, wow. asking him to, you know, quite graciously saying, you are a man who has a great deal of power in your hands, but if you will humbly take it from someone else who has had... some success with working with a nation, then I implore you to find a nonviolent way to. And so here you have two humans that are both on two ends of the spectrum, if you will, showing the capacity of the human being, which is constructive or destructive. And they are both embodied right there side by side. You could be a Gandhi, you could be a Hitler, mm-hmm. you could be either. The capacity is there.
Mm-hmm.
The range is there as well. So when I see that, I think we can be, you're right, we are good. We are good.
Mm-hmm.
We can also be horrible,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
but the capacity for both exists clearly, mm-hmm. clearly.
So. Where can people see the film?
So you can see it online anywhere now. It's on iTunes, it's on Google, it's on Amazon. If you go to our website, which is nationearth.com, it lists all 7 platforms. But just do a search for Unity documentary and it should lead you to the right place.
And what's next for you?
Well, I just did this one thing I can't talk about, but I just finished the script of a film that I was asked to put together. So that's done. And we'll see if what goes with that. And then I got this other thing that...
It's one of those ones.
I got another thing that...
It is all the stuff I can't talk about.
You know, sometimes I hint at it, but sometimes I should wait and just see what's going to happen.
We'll wait.
Yeah.
Just thank you for making this. It did change my life. Mm. And I just remember watching the end of that screening and there was just a huge... just silence. It was a preview because you were wanting feedback and stuff, mm-hmm. and everyone was just like, wow. Mm-hmm. So thank you, because it's inspired me to do all the stuff that I'm doing, which is content that is not that conflict, argumentative, destructive, that's an example of a world that we can live in. It's right. Just the kind of avenue of production that I'm going to be taking now. So thank you for doing that.
Thanks for watching it. I know it can be a formidable experience, but everybody will survive, you know, we'll all live. So, you know, if you want to see something that really might open you up potentially, then I often say it's like a yoga class, you know, you can talk about yoga, but until you go to a yoga class, and it could be any class, but let's just say yoga, and you go through it and you get into some of those positions that are uncomfortable, that stretch and burn, mm-hmm. and make you confront things longer than you'd like to. They make you hold it, and you're really going, okay, I want to get, you know.
But can we stop now? Yeah.
But when you're done and you're laying there at the end, you know, you feel reborn, renewed, you know. So that's
exactly what unity
that's
is.
That's what the film was to do. It was like, it was your yoga class.
Yeah. You know?
So.
I love it. Well, thank you. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Bye.